What you have to do in order to create your identity provider or your service provider. There are several ways to implement an identity provider or a service provider. There are several software available. The most famous are the Shibboleth and the SymbolSum PHP. SymbolSum PHP is one product that can be configured to work as an identity provider or as provider. With Shibboleth, you have two separate products. One for the service provider and one for IDP. Additionally, depending on the application you want to create as a service provider, it could handle some message inside your application using some libraries or implementing all the checks requested by someone. This is a possibility, although not many applications perform that way, only few applications are able to manage the some information. And even, for example, Shibboleth, who provides the library to implement the application, they suggest to avoid the library and use only if you have very good knowledge of SAML, because it can be quite complicated. There are a lot of options, a lot of stuff, so it's better to go with the application external to your web application. I will show you how. So in presentation, we will focus only on the Shibboleth IDP and SP. However, the idea, the concept, and some terminology is the same for other tools, so it can be possible for you, if you understand Shibboleth, go to SymbolSum PHP, although the configuration file format and application is quite different, because that is a PHP, it's a different way to configure and so on. So going to the Shibboleth, there is the link here to Shibboleth. Following this link, you go to the Shibboleth web page where you can download the software, and you can go to the documentation page. I will not provide you a detailed documentation on the installation. I suggest you to go to the wiki page of Shibboleth for the installation. It is very well. The documentation is too much detailed, so you. If you know the terminology, or you know all the steps, what is important to configure, what is not important, it can be difficult because you have a lot of information there. So the idea of this presentation is to provide the basic point where you have to go for the configuration. For the remaining part, or if you want to know more about some specific configuration, I suggest to go to the Shibboleth documentation. Starting from the link is in the slide. The service provider is provided as a module for Apache HTTPD web server. So when you have to deploy the service provider, you have to use with Shibboleth, you have to use the Apache web server to integrate the module. The module could be used also with Nginx, but as far as I know, it is not provided the binary module for Nginx. You have to get the source code to compile, do some customization during the compiling, and then deploy. So it is quite complicated. I have never tested with Nginx, so, and the documentation is not. It's oriented to Apache HTTPD, so I do not recommend to go with Nginx. Additionally, the Apache module is already available with many Linux distributions. So you can get the module with your package manager. If you are on Ubuntu, you have just apt-get and so on. Similar with the SUSE Linux, with Yast, or with Red Hat, CentOS, Red Hat based distribution, they have already the module. You have to use your package manager to install the Shibboleth SP module. We'll install the Shibboleth SP module for Apache. we restore the Shibboleth daemon because the model will communicate with the running daemon. We copy all the configuration file in the directory etc shibboleth. So in this directory you will get everything. If you are using Windows, this package for Windows, but you need to deploy on Windows, the configuration file are in a location depending on the installation path you provide during the installation. But you have the same files, the same everything. You also have the daemon for Windows that you can enable to start automatically when you reboot the machine. With the Linux, it's easier because it's already packaged. So when you open the configuration folder of Shibboleth, the file, the most important file you have to look at are the shibboleth2.xml, where you have to configure the session. You can configure the day of your application, you have configured the session, the lifetime, and so on. And you have to configure also the trusted IDP or the trusted federation. And then you have to configure the other two relevant files are the attribute map and the attribute policy, where you can specify which attribute you accept from the IDP, and if you want that filter or other to prevent not authorized user, because as I explained, you can perform the first authorization according to the attribute, so you can add the filter in this policy to decide if the user is okay or not. I will show you the files. So I have a folder copied from a running service, so it's a real working example. Okay, this is the shibboleth2.xml. But it's important here to define the application default, that is the application running with this shibboleth, is because the same shibboleth instance can be used with multiple applications. Application should have a different domain name. In any case, for sure, you must have a different entity for each application. To simplify, now we consider one shibboleth for one application. In this case, the entity is just the URL to your application / shibboleth. This is the most used way to identify the resource. It's not mandatory, but it's quite common to have this for the service provider. Then, okay, this is requested only for Tomcat because you can use application running on Tomcat with shibboleth. What you have to do is to connect Tomcat with Apache HTTPD, so Apache HTTPD with a proxy server for your Tomcat. It's recommended to use the AGP protocol. When you use this protocol, just to allow HTTPD to provide information to Tomcat, you have to add this attribute prefix. But it's only if you are using Tomcat. This is okay, you can leave what you get, or you can change it, because this is what is provided, which attribute will be provided to the application and remote user. It's a list. So the first not empty attribute will go to the remote user variable httpd. Then you have the session. This is very important. You can configure the lifetime of the session, so how long the shibboleth session is keep on by there. If you want how to handle the queue key, how to if to check the address from the user, just avoid different people using IDP and then connect to the services and so on. Then you have the single sign-on configuration, where you have to configure if you want to use the discovery service or not. If you want to use the discovery service, you have to specify the discovery protocol of some ODS, and then you have to provide the discovery URL, so the URL of the discovery service. If you are not using a discovery service, just you can provide here the entity ID and the ID of the IDP you want to use. the IDP has to be then configured in the trusted service. Then what is important here is to configure this metadata provider. The metadata provider is where you configure the resource. The IDP can enable to access this service provider. You can have as many metadata providers as you want. There's no limit. You can specify all that you want. You can have multiple metadata providers. In this case, there is only one, but you can have many metadata provider blocks. In this case, I am providing the URL of the federation of IDP. This is the file of the metadata, the federation, including all the sources of the federation. In this case, we said that this file is failed, and it's reloaded every 7,200 seconds. So this maintains a cache of the file. Then you can add the filter, because in this case, I check the signature of the file, so I check if the signature is correct for the file, and I can also check the signature of some IDP in this case. The signature is very important, because in order to be trusted the file, all the federation metadata file are signed, so it's important to check the signature. Then you can almost leave whatever everything you have. The only thing you could change, but you can also leave as you have, is the credential resolver. These are the link to the public and private key used for the metadata to sign the metadata. Currently, this when you use Shiba, it is configured with the self-certificate, and self-signed certificates are accepted by all the federations. So you can leave the file you already have. You don't need to change this key and certificate, but you can leave what you have. So to recap, what you have to configure is the entity ID. This, if you want, use Tomcat, otherwise you don't need this. So the attribute prefix for Tomcat, otherwise you don't need. The remote user, you can provide the value, or you can leave whatever you have VR, because this depends on how your application work. Then you have to configure the single sign-on, specify the discovery URL or the entity ID you want to use, and the metadata provider here. This is all you need for this file. And for the other two files, the attribute policy. The attribute policy allows you to define what kind of value attributes or the user attribute can have or is accepted by your service. If you leave as it is from your selection, you should have this at the end where you said that all attributes coming from the IDP are accepted by the shibboleth and go to the application. So you can decide to add the control of the attribute in your application instead of Shiba. You can decide if you want some filter, you can decide what kind of filter. If there are a lot of kind of filter, you can specify. Otherwise, this will provide all the attribute to the application, then you have to filter inside your application. What is asymptotic the attribute map? Yeah, it's just a list of attributes. We have a lot of attributes. This is the list of attributes recognized by your service provider. Now, if I remember correctly, when you install shibboleth, this is commented out. So this is all of this is commented out. But for example, in our federation, we use LDAP based attributes. So you have to uncomment this block from here to here. You have to uncomment this block because we are using LDAP based attribute. This is, of course, specific to the federation or the service you are trying to connect to. If you are using LDAP based attribute, you have to uncomment here. Otherwise, your SP in the IDP will provide the attribute, your SP will not recognize them. So it's important to uncommon. Okay, this everything for the Shibot configuration. Of course, when you perform the configuration, you have to restart Shibboleth daemon. The name of the daemon is Shibd. So you have to restart this daemon, and that's all for the configuration. After the configuration of Shibboleth, everything is okay. You have to go to the configuration of Apache, because you have to enable the Shibboleth authentication for your application. You it's in Apache, enable the module, Shibboleth module you have deployed with your package. When you install the Shibboleth package on your distribution, you can enable the modules using the approach followed by your distribution. If you have all the enabled module with links, or you have to write the file in a specific directory, this depends on the distribution. But you have to enable the module. When the module is enabled, when you want to add Shibboleth authentication on a location, you have to add this in the file defined the location. For example, this is the Apache configuration. I copied the directory containing the configuration for the some directories. No, it's not to this one. Okay, this one. What I want to show. Okay, this is the where I configured the virtual host of my service. What I want to show. Yeah. Okay. Here, I'm saying that if you want to access, for example, I take a directory, whatever. Okay, I'm saying if you want access the location node, so if you want to go to www.progettovespa.it/node, I am in HTTPS. If I go to this location, I request Shibboleth authentication. So I want authorization type Shibboleth. I require a valid Shibboleth session. I want that the user is identified by the DP, and I want the information to the user. So I require valid user. Okay. In this way, using the Apache and the module, I will get the authentication here. Apache will provide all the attributes coming from the IDP to the application. So you can, if you have not set the filter on the attribute policy, you can filter on the application, because all the attributes coming like email, username, and so on go to the application. Plus, the remote user variable of Apache is available, and this can be configured in the Shibboleth 2.xml as you, if you remember, in the application default. That's all for the Shibboleth SP. What is remaining is the configuration of your application. So the login in your application, instead of get the credential from the user, has to read the information from the environment, because Apache will put the attribute in the environment as an environment variable. So you have to collect this information from the environment. This depends if your application is in Java, is in PHP, in Python, and so on. It's that different. In case, just I can send you the link to the some material for your language, or you can find in thing also on the Shibboleth documentation is some information on to customize your application. In any case, we can provide the snippet of code for different languages just to collect this. Just to customize your application in order to use the Shibboleth authentication. Okay, let's move to the IDP side. The IDP is quite different because the IDP is a web application written in Java running on Tomcat. This web application performs the authentication, but not the user management, because this user management is out of scope of the Shibboleth. So you have to use a user you have to provide a user. So this can be an ADAP server or a MySQL server, or you can use also other approach. What we use, I use in our IDP is LDAP-based user management. For several reasons, I will not explain here, but all our configuration are based on LDAP for several reasons. And in any case, what Shibot provides is the software to connect this user store, user identity store with the SP. So is the software performing this analysis of the request coming from the service provider and to perform the authentication using the user identity store and create the SAMO to send back to the SP. This is the software provider. The software run on Tomcat 8. You saw the Shibot, this will create a directory where the file are located. Then you have to write a deployment file on Tomcat. The deployment file you can cut the paste from the Shibot documentation because you have not to change anything, just the path of your installation. Where did you install the Shibot IDP? As far as I know, the Shibot IDP doesn't come with your distribution. You have to download it from Shibot. Inside the directory where you saw the IDP, you will get the configuration directory. It's the directory conf. All the configuration can be performed. In Katana, we have developed also an Ansible role for the installation. You can use the Ansible to deploy the IDP. The Ansible role will perform the installation, will deploy on Tomcat. It will perform also some basic configuration with based on focused on LDAP identity store. I will also explain, I will show the file with LDAP, but it's not too complicated to move from LDAP to MySQL in case you want, if you already have a user identity store in MySQL. I've used LDAP, but it's also possible to put Active Directory because they use the same protocol, they change, there are only a few changes, so it is quite trivial to move from one to the other. So when you install the IDP, you configure Tomcat, then you have to configure a couple of things in the IDP. The main file to configure is the LDAP properties, because I'm using LDAP. If you use other user identity store, then you have to use different files. You will have MySQL properties, for example. You can use MySQL properties on something like that. This will configure the user authentication, but you also have to configure the attribute database. You have to configure the accepted SP, so the trusted resource you can connect to. So the file you have to configure are the LDAP properties, the attribute resolver, the attribute filter. This attribute resolver a filter you can think like the attribute map and the attribute topology of the SP. They are the equivalent for the IDP. As I said, the attribute can be stored in LDAP, any relational database like MySQL. We in Katana also develop a software for the user management in the LDAP. The software currently is in IDP Tomcat. Is the when you apply for the user account on IDP Open, you use that software because it's a web application that implements the a workflow to accept user in our LDAP. This is currently not running with Tomcat 8 because we have not upgraded to the last version, so I have not tested the software on Tomcat 8, but if you want, you can take the software and do a test because it's available on our repository. So let's go to the configuration file. I have copied the directory in NIDP currently deployed in our test infrastructure. This is the Shibot version 3. Let's close this one. So this is the file. The main configuration file is the IDP properties. Yeah, you can see the what you have to specify here is the entity ID is very important. The entity ID, because this will recognize your service inside the federation. The convention for IDP is like the SP, but we add this IDP. Then you have the addition properties file that we are requested. We use this LDAP properties where all the configuration go. And the last important thing to configure here is this one. This IDP scope. This stores the file and dependencies. This is my LDAP, and this is my LDAP configuration. All the configuration is done on the LDAP properties. So yeah, there's nothing to do, because if you have properly configured the LDAP properties, you don't need to configure this one, because the variables are already in the LDAP properties. Then the other file is the filter. This works in a very similar way of the attribute policy. Here is the list of, for example, I'm specifying that for all the service provider, so for all, I will release all this attribute. So I will release this edu personal person principal name, the method name, give them name, and display name. Here I said that for EthERNet, so it's a different service, I will release this one. So I will release this attribute. I can specify which attribute to which service, which attribute to release to which service, and even for an attribute I can specify also the value. Okay, and then we have to configure the metadata provider XML. This is the list of it's the same as for the SP. Metadata provider, we have to specify a list of files trusted by this service. In this case, we trust two federations, so we have two metadata provider block. The first one is the test federation, and here we have the block for our production federation, because this is registered with both federations. And this is the metadata provider. It's important. Finally, you have to configure also the authentication is performed during the when user provider how the user credential are last verified. In our case, we use JAS because it's made with LDAP. The LDAP is in this case was is for example for LDAP login module. In this case, you set LDAP on the local host. This is an example. This is an example to use user authentication with LDAP using JAS configuration. If you use MySQL, you can have to configure MySQL and authentication. Okay, here is the list of kind of authentication accepted. You have to configure everyone you want to use. So in the authentication folder, you have the list of authentication approach you can follow. You have to configure the LDAP using LDAP, or you have to configure the MySQL. Okay, after the configuration of your IDP or your SP, in order to use your IDP with other services, you have to exchange the metadata. When you create the shibboleth SP, or when you create the IDP, the identity provider, the system will generate a metadata file, and they will make this metadata public. For the IDP, if you go to the URL of your service slash IDP slash shibboleth, we provide the metadata of your IDP In case of DSP, there is also a path is a little bit more complex because that is the URL /shibat.sso/ I think it's profile/metadata or something like that. In any case, you can find the link on the documentation. But this metadata is just for initial test. You have to customize this metadata because some information are missed. There are only the part relevant for the authentication. So you can use this metadata for the authentication, but not to register to a federation. I guess you can get this metadata. You can get this file stored in your web server, add the missed information, then publish this metadata file with all the information in order to allow the federation to collect the metadata file and publish your service. Or to another service, if you are doing a point-to-point connection with a couple of services, you have to exchange this file with all the services in order to configure the file in the metadata provider. Okay, that's all us for the configuration.